This is Growing Forward, a collaborative podcast between New Mexico PBS and New Mexico Political Report, where we look at cannabis in New Mexico. I'm Andy Lyman with New Mexico Political Report.
And I'm Megan Kamrick, a New Mexico PBS correspondent and on-air host at KUNM.
Well, we all made it through the 2021 legislative session, but one thing that didn't quite make it was cannabis legalization.
Yeah, it really came down to the 11th hour, though. It seemed like it wasn't clear it was going to pass the final debate until there was only a couple hours left.
Right. The night before the session ended, I had been hearing talks that legalization was just not going to make it and that Governor Michelle Lujan Grisham had been planning to call a special session.
So, Andy, can you give us some bullet points about what happened in the last couple days of the session?
Sure. In our last episode, we talked about House Bill 12, which had sort of the best shot at making it to the governor's desk. And we also talked about how its last stop before the Senate floor was the Senate Judiciary Committee. It passed that committee after a pretty lengthy debate that ended around 1:30 in the morning. The chairman of that committee, Senator Joseph Cervantes, gave a pretty stern warning to the sponsors that he didn't think it was going to make it to the floor. But before it passed with a pretty narrow vote, the committee actually added quite a lot of changes. And so those changes combined with wording that Cervantes said would do the opposite of what it intended, really upped the stakes. And so it was also a little unclear what the bill was gonna look like on the Senate floor. But then on Friday night around 6, I started hearing that the bill probably wouldn't be heard on the floor at all, or even before the session ended at noon on Saturday. Then I started hearing that the governor planned to call a special session just for cannabis legalization. And sure enough, late Friday, the governor's office confirmed that a special session was a consideration. But even then, there was still a bit of optimism that they could pull it off. Republican Senator Cliff Pirtle from Roswell, it turns out, came up with a 100 plus page amendment. And I can only assume it was an attempt to get some language from his own legalization bill in there. And then at the wrap-up news conference, Senator Majority Floor Leader Peter Wirth said Pirtle's bill was a valiant effort, but that it wasn't ready. So here we are now. The governor said the special session will happen on or around March 31st. And generally speaking, special sessions aren't really all that long, so lawmakers could be done by the first week of April.
So we're going to get into the subject of equity shortly, but it seemed to me like there was a fair amount of concern from senators that the bill was written too favorably for existing medical cannabis producers, more specifically, as Cervantes said, the big guys.
Yeah, I definitely agree. And it's also sort of interesting to watch this, you know, potential new industry start from legislation and then in turn see the efforts to make it as equitable as possible from the start. And so after this podcast's longest introduction yet, let's get to our first guest. We are joined today by Natalie Fertig, a journalist with Politico who covers cannabis on a national level. Thanks so much for joining us today, Natalie.
Yeah, thanks for having me, you guys.
Natalie, part of the criticism here of this year's frontrunner bill and its predecessors in the past years was the length and how many issues it tried to cover. So compared to the states you've covered, how fair is that characterization of New Mexico's attempt this year? Did it try to do too much?
I mean, what we have to recognize about New Mexico's attempt is that New Mexico is still in the first round of states that are actually doing this through legislative action. I know that it's the 17th state, if will be the 17th state to legalize adult use cannabis if this bill passes, but the majority of those states have done so through ballot measures. And so legislatures have been going back in after regulations were passed and either trying to change things from the ballot measures that maybe didn't work. Colorado, for example, famously allowed medical patients to grow 100 plants at home for the first couple of years that the legislature then had to go in and drastically reduce that home grow limit, which was essentially a small farm. But other states that have done this through ballot measures, some of those ballot measures were very detailed and some of them were not. I think the closest to New Mexico would be either Virginia's legislation or Illinois' legislation, which both regulated cannabis and also addressed social equity, creating social equity funds and doing expungements. But some of the other states have not maybe done it that in that complicated of a fashion.
You've touched on the whole issue of plant counts, plant limits for growers. So what is the trend you're seeing across the country in terms of production control?
I mean, honestly, New Mexico, you guys are so interesting and an outlier in this whole thing nationally. I had to ask, I spoke with Representative Martinez about his bill at the beginning of the session, and I totally messed up. I had no clue what he was talking about with plant counts. I thought he was talking about home grow, and he had to correct me because it's not something I've actually ever heard before, putting a cap on the number of plants that can be grown. Usually states discuss caps on licenses, limiting the number of licenses that are out there, the number of people who can grow, and then they have separate licenses for different amounts of plants. So in California, you can have a tiny license for less than 5,000 plants. You can have a 5,000 to 10,000 plant license. But essentially in California, even you could stack 5,000 plant licenses to the ends of the earth if you had the space to do it. So the cap on plants is that's a New Mexico only thing. And as someone who covers a lot of these states, I'm very excited to see how this plays out.
You touched on Colorado not initially putting a limit, or at least you could grow up to 100 plants as a medical patient. Why did they come back and decide they had to fix that?
Yeah, so that was, I should specify that that is for home cultivation rather than people doing that for sales. Colorado and a lot of states early on, and Washington State actually did the absolute opposite, where they did not even allow recreational or adult use consumers to home grow at all. Colorado kind of met them in the middle on recreational home grow. But home grow has been this kind of weird existential issue on the periphery of marijuana legislation for the entire history of adult use cannabis in the United States. It's seen as an equity issue because, you know, access for medical patients, but also access for people who live in states like Pennsylvania, where medical marijuana is quite expensive. Communities of color do not have as much access to medical marijuana or recreational marijuana in those states where it's really expensive. And so it's seen as, it also, I should add, gives police one more reason to maybe go into someone's home. If there's no home grow allowed and they see a marijuana plant in the backyard, it gives them a reason to enter someone's home. And that continues the incarceration aspect of cannabis policy. But it's not been a major issue in any state. Washington state is just now going back and looking at changing home grow limits. Colorado, like I mentioned, went in a couple years later and said 100 is essentially a micro business. We don't need you to grow 100 plants, and lowered it to 12. That number is one I hear a lot from medical consumer or patient advocates as a good number, because cannabis grows in cycles. So if you have a 12 plant limit, you're not growing all 12 at one time. It's not like tomatoes where you pick a tomato and then another one grows back on the same plant. You have to like harvest the whole plant. So having more later to come back is a good thing. But some states have a 2-plant limit. It's all across the board right now. And it's an issue that states are kind of discovering what works best for them and the people within the state.
And you just touched on this, but how did other states that have legalized try to address some of those social justice or equity issues that the New Mexico legislation had?
Well, it's been a bumpy ride. California was one of the first states, along with Massachusetts and Illinois, to create social equity programs. Illinois was the first state to just blanket expunge nonviolent, low-level cannabis-related records, looking for that word. But even some of these programs that were early, Massachusetts program, for example, has hit a lot of hurdles. Because one of the things that a lot of lawmakers did not recognize was that you can give equity applicants a head start, but you also need to give equity applicants the means to then succeed with that license or with that priority status. I've seen in reporting on California, a lot of the people getting licenses are people coming from the real estate industry. You know, they have been dealing with licensing and city permitting, and they have deep pockets and they have deep pocketed friends. And then you see someone coming from one of the communities and the zip codes that have been most impacted by the war on drugs, and they don't have deep pocketed friends. They don't have deep pockets themselves. They don't know how to talk to city council people. They don't know how to file all the complicated paperwork. And so even though they have priority status in the system, they're still not getting open. Their doors aren't getting open. And a lot of the people with the power, a lot of the white men who, you know, have the institutional knowledge, which, you know, not placing blame or anything, but that's the system and that's the reality, are progressing further than the equity applicants. It's a very, very complicated problem to solve.
That's really interesting. It's like Bill is owed this new industry here, a new source of revenue, whole new world. It replicates the same power structures we already have.
Yeah, well, and that's the thing. I've talked to people in Massachusetts and in Southern California where I think these issues are the most obvious right now. And they've talked about how it's not just about solving cannabis criminalization. It's about changing an entire system of racism and economic racism in the United States. And you can't just fix one part of that and expect the whole system, or expect that system to work differently from all the other systems. Even if you've changed one part of it, you still need to give access. And also federal illegality continues to impact those systems as well. I talked to Kat Packer, who's in charge of Los Angeles's cannabis industry. And she told me that the money that they receive from the federal government to help lower income communities start small businesses is not accessible to the cannabis industry because that's federal funding. And so the city didn't think about that and take that need, that extra need for funding into account when they passed those equity programs. And then they were scrambling to try to find the funds to then help these people in an industry where starting a cannabis dispensary can be $1 million or more.
It recently came to light that some White House staffers were scrutinized for their previous cannabis use. And you recently wrote that it really shouldn't be all that surprising to anybody that's kind of followed President Biden's record. Is there a point where the number of states legalizing cannabis recreational use kind of forces a view change in the White House?
I'm not a White House reporter. I can't speak to President Biden's specific viewpoint on cannabis. There's been some good reporting done out there on his view on it, that he has a lot of grandkids and he has some worries about the impact that legalization could have on kids. But I think that really the focus should be on Congress. Congress is where cannabis is going to be legalized. And I hear people obsessing over the White House and what does Biden think about it. And Congress is in charge of the Controlled Substances Act, ultimately. They're the ones who could remove cannabis from the Controlled Substances Act entirely. The White House's system for doing that would be much more convoluted, probably take longer, and is more likely to result in a rescheduling rather than a descheduling, at least from all of the experts that I've talked to on this subject. The White House can get involved in slowing things down on Capitol Hill, but Senator Schumer is incredibly dedicated, at least rhetorically, to this issue. He's up for re-election in New York State, which I think is a very important point that should be made when we're talking about states legalizing. In a roundabout answer to your question, it does have a huge impact on Congress. And, you know, you have to think Biden may not run in 4 years. So what are the political, what's the politics at play there in pushing him to change his mind on this issue? But the politics for Chuck Schumer is very strong. New York City or New York State is also considering legalization this year, along with you guys. It's a big deal in New York. They very much want cannabis. It's also very much seen as a criminal justice reform issue, which is very strong amongst New York State voters. And so that's pushing Chuck Schumer to prioritize this, which could also push that it to happen altogether in Congress.
So just kind of briefly, can you catch anybody that may not be up to date on this, why it was so newsworthy that the president sort of took some action against staffers that admitted to using cannabis?
I think the major newsworthiness of it, I think, is that a lot of people don't realize that there are Democrats that don't want cannabis legalization to happen. But covering Congress, you can see it's honestly a more generational issue than it is a Republican-Democrat issue. I talked to a lot of young Republicans who are very in favor of cannabis legalization. I mean, Matt Gaetz, for example, a Florida Republican, was one of the few Republicans to vote in favor of the MORE Act, which was the legalization bill that passed last year. A lot of Republicans will also, maybe they wouldn't go as far as the MORE Act, which had expungements and social equity programs and a lot of things that Republicans just don't believe should be part of federal legislation in any type of legislation. But a lot of younger Republicans are in favor of at least removing it from the Controlled Substances Act. But then you've got some older Democrats that you see drag their feet on legalization, like California Senator Dianne Feinstein is definitely one of those people I would put in the category of heavy feet draggers on marijuana. And I think that Biden falls in that category of an older generation that sees marijuana as something that is very harmful to youth and has a lot of questions about legalizing it. His White House did promise that they would de-emphasize marijuana on applications. And that is a step that the federal government is totally able to take, just like any business is able to say, hey, this is federally illegal, but we are not going to prioritize rejecting you or rejecting your application because of this. Our reporting on this is not yet clear if these people who applied for jobs or were currently working at the White House had simply disclosed that they used marijuana and were fired for that, or if there was something extra going on, like they'd lied on their forms or there was other drug use involved. We're not completely sure. There's been some reporting to along both of those veins, but the point is that the White House and the federal government are still in conflict with what states are doing. So if someone lives in Washington, D.C. and works for the federal government, they live in a city that has had legal marijuana since 2014. But if they work for the federal government, they could be let go for legally using that marijuana. So it's this huge conflict of laws.
That's so interesting.
Well, I will encourage everyone to go read Natalie's work at Politico, and I'll keep an eye out for it too. But for now, Natalie, I just want to say thank you so much for joining us today.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me on. And thanks for all of the help during the New Mexico session. You guys have a really interesting state and a really interesting legislature, and I've enjoyed covering it. So hello to all the New Mexicans.
Thanks, Natalie.
Thanks so much.
Now that we have caught up everyone on what happened at the end of the legislative session and heard about what's happening on a national level, we're going to turn our attention to equity in the cannabis industry. We're joined by Moises Gonzalez. He's an assistant professor at the University of New Mexico. He's also a leader in the Cañon de Cañue land grant and is co-editor of the recent book, Nación Genisora, Ethnogenesis, Place and Identity in New Mexico. Moises, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you for having me on the show.
There were a number of bills seeking generally to do the same thing this year, that is to legalize recreational use cannabis. But as we mentioned earlier, House Bill 12 was the one that got the farthest in the process. The sponsors of that bill, Representatives Javier Martinez and Representative Andrea Romero, said one of the more important parts of the bill was social justice and equity. And on the equity front, the bill would have allowed for micro licenses with lower registration costs. There were a ton of amendments at the end, but Moises, did the original version go far enough to provide equity?
No, there's still a lot of uncertainty and, you know, given COVID and a lot of, not understanding in terms of even the process, how the bills were heard, how you could log in and how you could give, give input into the bill. And so I think, there was an expungement in one of the earlier versions of the bill. There was discussions of micro grows, as you know, I would call them. And then the bill started shifting, and especially toward the end, you know, you had Senator Cervantes pull expungement from the, so as the bill went on, it wasn't equitable to start with. And it got worse as it progressed through the process, which is alarming because there was no protections for rural-based Osecchia land grant based communities, something that I'm, you know, as the president of the Cañon de Conway land grant that I'm concerned about. And, you know, what we're seeing right now, what Osecchia folks and land grant folks in the San Luis area are telling us,
In Southern Colorado.
Yeah, Southern Colorado is right now, you know, the demand on water and the demand for growing is now impacting essentially a Osecchia gentrification of water in the San Luis Valley, which, you know, I don't think we're prepared for that in New Mexico. And so that's a huge concern for me. And then the other thing is just how the medical marijuana industry get the lockdown of the first licenses, and how even micro grows can't even have small dispensaries. If we're talking about rural economic development, how can a small few growers in the land grants and Osecchias, you know, do a small, it was debated whether 100, 200 plants, and then be able to have a storefront. Of course, there's all these security, I get that. But there's no consideration. I mean, what we're seeing is lobbyists such as the group called Ultra Health, who owns some of the medical dispensaries in various states and even here. And, you know, I mean, it's no lie that the contributions follow directly to Javier Martinez and follow directly to Governor Lujan Grisham. So this should not be this so-called Democrat liberal thing when it is. All it is to me, is one last thing I'll say on the bill about is there's still, I think, a fourth or fifth degree felony if you don't, if you grow, you know, within the bill, if you don't follow the rules for personal growth. So I think for growing whatever the plants, whether it was debated at 3 and 6 and kept on going through the debate, we should have a grow by right for anyone in the state of New Mexico, just like Colorado and everywhere else. So the argument is, let's expunge and let's do this for people of color, but everything in this bill is about gentrification and the corporate takeover of marijuana and the further dispossession of in the criminal system, well, furthering criminality within communities of color, and also further exploiting the rural resources.
So go ahead, Andy.
I just want to mention that I confirmed with the governor's office earlier this week that the discussions are still in the beginning stages, and then at least some of these concerns that we're talking about today are being considered. Also want to point out that, you know, that HB 12 is essentially dead, that they may take language from it, but it's not going to be a carryover. With all that being said, Moises, what concerns do you have of some of these, if some of these things don't make it into the next version and they say we're going to leave it to rule changes?
It's really scary because everyone says, well, we'll fix it the next time around. We know what the next time around means in big issues of with big corporations, with say like the oil and gas industry. We know what that means in terms of the big, big lobbying efforts. Energy should be the precedent. We're creating an industry that's predicted to project this amount of growth, but yet we have no say in it. So I think it's alarming to me that if some of the things that rural communities and community of color and folks are saying that of concern, some of the issues I've mentioned, if they don't make it in, it further projects that in New Mexico, if you're a the film industry, the oil and gas industry, certain particular industries, defense, the environmental justice that still hasn't happened in places like the Española Valley from toxic waste from Los Alamos, the plume in Sandia Lab, some of the environmental racism issues that are faced in communities like Mountain View regarding all the industrial uses. It's just continuing the perpetuation of New Mexico as a colonial state that industry can come in and people of color and indigenous people are expendable.
So I know you're not opposed to legalizing cannabis, Moises, but what would true equity look like for you in legalization for people in rural communities, people of color?
Well, one would be some sort of investment. So I think what some of the equities would be protections regarding water rights, water right transfers, uses of water within this sort of industry. Even if they're in urban areas and it starts project, so some sort of water accountability, some sort of investment that way. You know, we had hemp. I put this out there when I was trying to get information on the hemp industry. There's not nowhere were there any information about how many people of color, minority farmers were involved that had licenses to grow hemp and actually made money on it, right? So I think a couple of things is, a few things I'd like to state is, one is transparency on race and where these industries, where are they coming from? Where is their investment coming? Investment into rural communities and protections for water and land, ways in which small operators can get into the business, a grow by right by community, by any individual in New Mexico, just like any other state that's done with deal with recreation, and eliminate the criminality aspects that follow with that. Don't allow 2 years or any, you know, any industry shouldn't have the one up. The way the House Bill 12 was, is that the cannabis industry as it exists now has, you know, has investment to be able to get into the business. What I look at is the beer, the microbrewery and the spirits industry in New Mexico. It got to the point that partly the reason the alcohol rules or regulation is because they're working so well for local business and breweries. To me, let's look at the brewery.
I think that's a good model to follow.
Yeah, I think it models it. And there's still going to be criticism that there's gentrification around that. There's no lie in that. But, you know, you have Nexus, an African-American owned business that came from the South, from South Broadway. You have the Canyon de Carnival Land Grant. We have a tap room connected to a brewery. You know, you can make that connection. So I think allowing those investments and then an equitable review, like who are holding these licenses, where, you know, how does equity eventually make it into the marketplace?
I just wanted to point out to kind of to your point, Moises, that it seems like the maybe unintentionally the Department of Health has limited the licenses, right? It's, you mentioned the liquor industry. It's my understanding is that it's been years since they've opened up the licenses. And so now you have this group of medical producers who may or may not get that head start in growing, right?
Mm-hmm. Exactly. I mean, 2 years is what House Bill 12 was calling for. A 2 years health bump on anybody else. You know, I think rural communities you know, it should be written the other way around. I mean, we're not going to get everything we want, but if we want to talk about really taking an industry where people of color got the brunt of things like, you know, in terms of incarceration, criminalization, and lives were ruined, we should be the targets, the communities that are targeted for some sort of reconciliation on that, not further, you know, not further oppression.
And when you say grow by right, you mean if this is going to be legal, then anyone should be able to grow this on their land.
Like, well, in Colorado, you have, I think it's 6 plants, vary from state to state. California, some states have 12 where you get so many females, so many males. I think a good number would be 5 female plants that anyone could grow. And, you know, and then the argument is, oh, well, that'll just that'll kill recreational marijuana. Not everyone's going to grow 5 female plants, you know, and I think that's the thing. And then the thing is, one portion of the bill, I believe you had to pay for your license. In Colorado, you don't have to pay. So let's say you're growing a couple of plants, you don't pay the fee, then you're subject to a 5th degree felony. I mean, nothing tracks here on a logical trajectory of what the bill, House Bill 12 argued it, what it was going to do. And so, so Andy, you know, going back to what you were mentioning, you know, I don't think we're going to get everything we want, but there has to be something about equity, you know, in terms of moving forward.
All right. Well, thanks so much for joining us, Moises. We appreciate it.
Hey, thank you for having us. And I just hope, you know, that we can get the word out on this. And thank you so much.
You've been listening to Growing Forward, the podcast about cannabis in New Mexico in a collaboration between New Mexico PBS and New Mexico Political Report. Our producers are Kevin McDonald and Bryce Dix. Our theme song is by Kristen Bjoerklund. Special thanks to Katherine Conley for our logo. Don't forget to subscribe to Growing Forward wherever you listen to podcasts and leave us a review to let us know how we're doing.